I'd like to welcome Martin Lambie-Nairn to Time's Lecture.
Now, let's get a grip of this. What I thought I'd do is this. I'll just tell you a little bit about Lambie-Nairn and the company and what we do, just to give you some idea of the sort of work we do, and show you a quick show reel. That's what I thought I'd do first. And then I thought I'd do take you through case studies. The first thing that I'm going to talk about is something that you will all know and have seen, and unless you don't have a television set, which for 4 years I didn't, by the way, which didn't do me any good with one of my clients, being a television designer. Anyway, and that's going to be the BBC corporate identity. Now, the reason, that's not a new job by any means, as you know, but I think once you hear it and how it was actually achieved, you may agree with me that it is actually quite an important job. And the fact that it's not used now is life. One imagines that if you actually get what we do right, and it works, and is, you know, everybody's enthusiastic about it, you imagine that that's sorted that, and then we can move on. But no, what happens is a new bunch of people arrive, and they go, "What's all that?" in the bin, and they start again. It's like 20 years ago, and so it all gets binned. But that's what we do, and that's part of our life. There's no point in worrying about it. It's a great privilege to work with people like the BBC, and they're a great stage. So, right. Rebranding of the BBC. This has started some a while ago, and you may remember this logo type. This is a I'd been working for the BBC on the broadcasting side for quite a little while, but the BBC is a very strange animal. It is a very large animal, and it is run by independent fiefdoms. The greatest of all the fiefdoms is broadcasting, and there lies the power. But there are fiefdoms called corporate and engineering and world service and like with all large organisations, they all hate each other, and they spend their lives trying to stick it. Oh, I just realised we're being broadcast. Okay, right. I hope you've got an editing facility in the back. Okay, it's human nature. Large organisations are not peaceful things, not necessarily are small organisations, but this was not a peaceful organisation. Anyway, along comes a new guy who they employ to run the corporate side of design. And this is the logo type that he has inherited. And he happened to say to us, "Well, look, how many, put your finger up if you heard this one. We'd like to change the logo. Would you go away and play with it?" I said, I'm running a business, and I don't go away playing with people's logos. I mean, there was no brief, that was the brief. So I said, well, I said, that's not the way. First of all, it's not a logo issue. It's a great deeper issue than that. But one of the issues that they had is that Michael Peters and partnership had designed this logo type for the corporate affairs department, and it didn't work on television. It's just not great, because they do quite a bit of that, as you know. But that's just a demonstration of how disconnected this whole thing was, and how actually unimportant they thought that what people like you and I do, they don't think it's terribly important to the business. Well, we think it's massively important to the business. Okay. So this was the thing they gave us. We actually, what they asked for three groups to go away and look at the logo, and we said, well, we're not going to get a look in. If we don't actually go and take it away and come back with a response, we're not going to be even on the list. So we came back with a response which has nothing to do with the logo. It was actually just, before you can even touch the logo type, even if you just took those bars from under the logo type and didn't put them up anymore, just changed it at that level, you're into a bill of around 20 to 30 million pounds. Because you've got offices and goodness knows what. There are signage people in here, and where it, you know, signage normally costs the most part of any corporate identity, I think. And so you've got all that going on. So be careful. You know. The second thing is, if you're going to spend £20 million, can you think about what the front page of The Sun is going to say when they find out that £20 million? Oh, right. I mean, in fact, there was, I do have the copy of the front page of The Sun where they accused me of £5 million for straightening up the logo and all that kind of thing. So it doesn't matter what you do, you're going to get that. So it's a PR issue. And there were, so if you can't solve the PR issue and you can't understand that, by some kind of changes in this, there's going to be a sort of earthquakes around you and you can't get that organized, there's no point in doing anything. So we came back with a plan that would solve all those problems. We said you need to change the logo because it doesn't work in all the mediums that you need to work in. Right, you're right there. However, so we then looked around the entire organisation. We found out that because they were going into digital broadcasting, they had lots of new products they were starting to produce, and they all have budgets. And part of those budgets were a branding budget. So we counted up all those budgets, and we went around the entire organisation, and we took the money from those budgets, and in theory, and went back and said, okay, if you do it this way, then by claiming that money, you then can solve the PR problem, because it would now only cost you £5 million. And the way we can make the savings there, but if we look at the stationery, the way you do the stationery, we can make massive savings, and those massive savings will pay for the identity. So we then had the plan, which we thought was jolly clever, but they thought it was crap. First of all, they said, what the hell do you know about all this? You're a graphic designer, which is one thing that gets right out of my nose. the idea that graphic designers don't have brains really does it for me big time. So they said, right, well, you haven't got the job. The partners came in who are friends of ours, and they took the logo and they made it a little bit more, leaned it even further, and that was a possibility, and it's just bonkers. Anyway, so the television person on this board then said, well, actually, before we're going to do anything, before we accept anything, we're going to get this tested on screen, and Martin is going to test it on screen, because I was her consultant for the television, which is a bit odd. Here we are, we were part of the competition, but we were going to test the others. But we did it absolutely squeaky fairly, absolutely open, fair, whatever. And of course, all of the other things fell apart because they suffered from the same problems that this thing suffered from. So eventually got the job. Okay, so that's... Right, okay. So what I'm going to show you, I get a bit of a break here. What I'm going to show you is the very first presentation that we did, just before this was accepted, we had to put a presentation together to say how we would approach this project. And I did 180 presentations. It's a little bit like being in repertory for a year, where sometimes I'd have 12 people and sometimes I'd have 100 people and 400 people. And you'd walk into the room where everybody hated you, and the idea was you walked out with everybody loved you. That was the name of the game. Anyway, so after all, we just couldn't keep doing this. So we made a television presentation. We did a program of it, and it's sort of like 7 or 8 minutes program. So I'm going to show you that now. The quality is absolutely appalling. The acting is a little appalling. So I'll talk about don't give up the day job. The glasses are fairly interesting, but the quality is not actually great. But it does actually, the reason I'm showing you this, it actually gives you an idea of how we go about a project. Someone may ask us to design something, but we may go in and suggest there's something else to be done first, right?
This all started for us as a television project. The BBC was about to create a whole series of new television channels. How they were going to be branded was going to be a very important issue.
At exactly the same time, corporate affairs was looking at the whole visual image of the corporation to see if it was capable of serving all the corporation's needs into the 21st century. Clearly, it made sense for the two projects to become one. This film is a summary of progress to date. Not the full story, but a broad explanation of the vision and the way forward.
The way the BBC designs its logos for television brands at the moment revolves around three elements: corporate logo, brand name or numeral, and personality of the brand.
So the reason BBC World uses this typeface is because it reflects the channel's output, news and information. This approach is also used for the radio networks, BBC Radio, a numeral with personality, and finally, frequency. But these aren't the only logos the BBC owns. I know. In fact, under the prevailing branding system, if it's got a name, it's got a logo. There's a logo for locations, the shop has a logo, even the club has a logo. This results in the BBC being the proud owner of zillions of logos.
With the BBC about to play a leading role in the digital revolution, the team realised that following the existing branding system for all the new BBC channels and services would mean simply adding more and more logos.
The problem with zillions of logos for any corporation is that they weaken the core brand. Not only that, but they cost a lot of money, between £2,500 and £6,000 each. At the time we got involved in this project, the BBC was generating about 2 logos a week.
Obviously, it was time to call a halt and review the whole process.
The first thing we needed to do was to ask the question, what's the most important part of the identity? And obviously, it's these three letters. More than anything else, they represent a famous brand. They're associated with quality, integrity, and all the positive values of the organisation.
The next stage was to consider the existing brand logo. After all, it focuses on the BBC initials. So what's the problem?
Well, actually, there are 4 sets of problems. Firstly, there are the technical problems. It doesn't work on screen, because when reduced, the little lines disappear, and so do the counters. That's the little bits in the centre of the letters. And off-screen, when it's a colour logo on a colour photograph, it's again possible to disappear. There are other technical problems, but these are problems enough.
The team also identified strategic design problems.
Now, if this looks vaguely familiar, that's because it's meant to. It has its roots in the 60s, or was it the 50s? But the problem is that bringing elements of the design across to this new logo, the designers also imported a specific period feel. Not quite the values you want for a global corporation going into the 21st century.
The logo didn't work tactically either, alongside other BBC services and products.
The problem here is that you can never get the brand names to look comfortable alongside the diagonal logo. See what I mean?
Finally, the logo didn't work financially.
It's a 4-colour letterhead at its cheapest, but you also have 7-colour and even 10-colour letterheads. And that costs.
Before redesigning the BBC corporate logo, certain criteria had to be established. Technically, it would have to work in all media, from television, laptops and websites, to a range of printing processes. Strategically, it needed to avoid being identified with any particular era. Tactically, it would need to work with all the BBC output areas, accommodating new ones, be simple to manage, and sit alongside all the different brand personalities. Financially, it would have to be less expensive to produce. Finally, there was an aesthetic consideration. The actual standard of design would have to be at a world-class level.
So, with all this criteria in mind, we were in the market for a typeface. We settled on Gill Sans, not surprisingly designed by a man called Eric Gill. He was a master type designer who was most famous around about the 1930s. He was also a wonderful sculptor, and rather appropriately, you can find his sculptures around Broadcasting House. Eric Gill also represents that high standard of craftsmanship for which Britain and the BBC are renowned throughout the world. This is what we call the lovey argument. For those of us for whom the creative product is important, a very convincing argument it is too. But even for the loveyest of the loveys amongst us, the main reason was far more practical. The BBC needed a typeface that was robust and elegant. Gill fits the bill to a T, you might say.
As a result, what was recommended was a very simple but highly significant change from this to this.
By doing this, we solve all the technical problems in one hit. No fine lines, no disappearing counters. As you can see, we've kept the boxes and straightened them up. If we'd used a completely different shape to contain the letters, the result would have looked more like the Banstead Borough Council or the Bic Biro Company. It would have lost its BBC-ness.
The team realised that neither the aesthetic nor the technical arguments on their own would be reason enough to justify a project as big as a wholesale change in corporate identity.
However, the most compelling argument for changing the logo is this. What we do about this is dependent on the jobs it has to do. It has a corporate job, a nation's job, a region's job. It needs to work with the directorates. It has a commercial job. Then come the brands, TV brands, radio brands, and local radio brands. Now, even if you forget the aesthetics for a minute, this system delivers two benefits. One, it all looks like it comes from the same organisation. And two, you can add any name you like to it after the BBC logo. What it doesn't deliver is personality. So for the brands, we need to inject personality another way. When you look at consumer brands, this is precisely how they approach the problem.
Levi's is a highly successful and visible consumer brand, which has a series of brand values which it wants to communicate to its target markets. The Levi's logo itself does not communicate all these values. That task is left to the marketing.
Like Levi's, we didn't try to put all the personality into the logo, but recognised that each BBC brand would have a property of its own to do that job. In the case of BBC Two, what the audience enjoys are the antics of the twos, not the logo design. The twos are famous, they communicate emotionally, and it's through them that people decide what they feel about the channel. So we'll keep twos and simply add the BBC Two logo. The other new channels can develop their own properties as required, without destroying the consistency of the corporate identity.
The new brand identity also works for all the other on-screen elements, including the dog, the digital on-screen graphic in the top left-hand corner of the screen, program menus, and uses the same type for all channels, centered to accommodate widescreen.
All this means two things. Firstly, it means a proportion of all BBC television channels in the future have been designed right now. The use of the logo and the typeface have already been determined. All that needs to be devised is the channel property. The effect of this would be that the channel identities will be considerably cheaper to produce. And the second benefit is that the BBC will have a way of doing television channels. The channel's typography consistent, but all the channel's personalities different.
This principle applies to all areas of the BBC, whether TV or radio. The new system also translates into print as a much simpler corporate styling, which delivers an enormous cost saving to the corporation. It also works on books and magazines, on websites and multimedia. In short, on anything that may be part of the BBC, both now and in the future.
Okay, right, so that was the first presentation, laying out the plan. We then set about doing it, and we then spent sort of like 7 years working with them on different channels and things like that. What I'm going to show you now is the kind of how this thing worked. And you'll see that there are no such things as logos anymore. It's just that logo and the light line of type. And then it stops. And I'll try and stop the thing, DVD thing, before we go into that. Because there's something happens that causes the system to fail. Remember that the BBC One had owned the Globe for years and years and years, and we've come up with this idea that the BBC One brings the world to every corner of the United Kingdom, hence the Globe, hence. We actually did make this Globe. Just quickly, we made the balloon, we flew the balloon, and it peed with rain, and it always flew the wrong way. And so after 3 months of that and losing rather a lot of money and getting some rather dull photography, we decided we'd do the photography separate from the balloon, and we computer generated the balloon, and suddenly it flew in the right direction and so on and so forth. So, and there's no way you can tell the difference. Although the idea of that balloon, by the way, was that it wasn't just about being on television. We wanted to fly it over Manchester and fly it over. We wanted it to be at the Derby, and we wanted it to be at Wimbledon and things like that. But they just wouldn't do it. And it's just, it would have been really fantastic, wouldn't it? Fantastic PR, wow. If you're in Manchester and this thing goes across, what the hell is that? I mean, you know, it's the BBC One balloon, it all of Manchester would see it. But anyway, it doesn't have to be only Manchester, by the way. Right, okay. Part of the first set of the BBC Two stuff. It still makes me laugh. But to me, this kind of demonstrated it's not all about logos. And I think it happens not only just in television, but television in particular has this thing where executives want to be like the competition. So they get, you know, if their logo type is not like the competition's logo type, they think there's something wrong with their logo type. You know, because if you've seen Discovery Channel, they have a globe and they have colours and they have this dinner. And when they go to these dinners and they've sponsored something and it comes their logotype up against Discovery Channel or something like that, they go, well, ours has got less colours. The fact that Discovery Channel is probably the worst logotype on the entire broadcast network system doesn't seem to mean anything. And the fact that theirs is clearer doesn't mean anything either. So what happened then, there was a few of that. Well, we want to look, our channels have got to have logos, real logos, not things you put on, Martin, real logos. So we then went through a process where we had to redesign BBC One, BBC Two, BBC Three, BBC Four, and I didn't get my way with BBC Three. You'll see why in a minute. And they said, if you aren't going to do it, Martin, we'll get somebody else to do it. So I thought, well, it'd probably be better if I did it. Not much, but... Suddenly we've got logos, but then it's still playing the same ideas. This sequence doesn't actually exist. It's not film, it's a digital program that is original every time. It's fed by sound, by lots of different visual stuff. And the computer works out which one it's going to choose each time. That's not a very good explanation, particularly to our digital friends over here. I could do better. It takes a long time. But basically, the sound triggers the visual.
Three is a magic number. Yes, it is. That's a magic number.
There's something here.
Can I just tell you, I'm wearing glasses at the moment. With this pair of glasses, I can do terrible damage to you.
It's a bit of we've
to have a client who was going to risk for us, because a lady called Pam Masters, who was head of what was called the presentation department, who she went off and got the budgets, and she believed in us, and without that partnership we wouldn't have been able to do that kind of work, and she was massively important to us. And there were a couple of cases when she wanted me dead because it was the risk too far. But all of that work, when you think of the context of the period that that work was going on, was completely different than anything was going on anywhere else, and that was due to her being very brave indeed. On the BBC Two thing, the reason there was a change, it went to that stuff on a yellow background and became a bit lighter and more humorous, was because a new programme controller came in and changed the programming, and it was less serious. And they wanted to attract more BBC One audience and some of the Sky audience across to BBC Two, and so the identity had to reflect that, and that's why we redesigned it. And we thought seriously about dumping the two. It must have been very brave, is all I can say. But then, and for all of my working with the BBC, that all the BBC people have always said that the stuff before the yellow stuff BBC Two was a character, and I say no, it's not a character, it's a thing, it's not a character, all right? And they say no, it isn't. No, it's not a character. And so this went on year in, year out, and I used to get really upset about it when somebody piped up with us in meetings, and not upset, but you know. And when we had no idea what we were going to do for this new BBC Two program controller, we sat in the meeting and up, somebody piped again, some poor unsuspecting innocent said, well, you know, the BBC Two is a character, and I was lifting out of my seat, grabbing by the throat across the table, and suddenly went, oh, I think that's the answer. So that person gave us the answer in that meeting, so I just gave the thing a half. Right.